not who I used to be. I am redeemed. I'm redeemed. All my life I have been called unworthy. Named by the voice of my shame. Good morning, church. It's great to be with you for worship today. We're glad to have you with us as we come before the Lord for a time of His Word and of singing praise to Him. We're continuing a series we've been working on this summer called The Songs of the Church, where we've looked at a lot of different songs that are either well-known, traditional, handed down to us from generation to generation, or some that are newer, but just kind of really, we could say, potent and poignant reminders of what God has promised us and where we've failed Him as sinners, but also the promise of restoration He gives us in Christ Jesus. Now, today we're turning to another song that has kind of been handed down for a few generations, that's called How Firm a Foundation, that is laid for our faith in the Word of God. We're going to look more at what that means in just a minute, but before we get too far into the service today, we want to just take a moment to share the peace of God with the people that are worshiping along with us. If you're on YouTube or Facebook, you can write a comment, peace of God be with you. You could drop a like, that might be a good way to do it. Send a text to someone, take a moment, pause the video, make a phone call, something like that. Share the peace of God with the people who are worshiping along with you today. But when I hear you whisper, child, lift up your head, I remember, oh God, you're not done with me yet. And I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains and wipe away every stain. Now I'm not who I used to be, because I don't have to be. The old man inside of me, 'cause his day is long dead and gone. Because I've got a new name, a new life, I'm not the same, and a hope that will carry me.
Our God is the Lamb. who could stop the Lord Almighty? Who could stop the Lord?
That time of the service where we come before our God and lay before Him our failures to be the kind of people that He has called us to be at baptism, and hear His word of assurance and forgiveness. And so I invite you to join me as we confess our sins. Please follow along and join in with the words that are on the screen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways. To the glory of your holy name, amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us. And for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in his name, he gives power to become the children of God. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our sins from us. In the name of Jesus, you are forgiven today. Amen. Please join me now as we take a stand in our faith and confess a faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed, that formula by which Christians have identified themselves for hundreds of years. And so we confess together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Hey kids, it's time for a children's message. If you want to come a little closer, you can do that. Stay right where you are, of course, as well. Today I want to talk to you quickly about promises. Have you ever made a promise to someone? What kind of promises have you made to people? You might have promised, let me play with this toy first, and then I'll let you play with it. You might have promised your mom or your dad that I'll clean up my room, or I'll clean up the playroom as soon as I'm done with this thing, or I'll do it tomorrow, something like that. We make promises, right? Have you ever had a promise made to you? Maybe your mom and dad promised they're going to take you somewhere, your favorite place for dinner, or the other day my son tried to get me to promise that I would take him to Legoland in Southern California. A promise I did not make. Parents make promises to kids too, though, right? Now, when a person makes a promise to you, whoever they are, how do you decide whether or not you believe that promise? How do you know whether or not you can trust that promise or you can be confident in it? How do you know that what they say is going to come true? Now, a lot of times, the way we know that is because in the past, they've done what they've said they would do. In fact, if somebody always comes through with what they've said they'll do, that you are going to trust them in the future when they say they'll do something too. On the other hand, if someone doesn't always come through with what they promise to you, then it can be kind of hard to trust them. Today, we're going to be looking at a song that talks about the confidence and the trust that we can have in our God. And the reason is because he's always done what he says he would do. All throughout the scriptures, God promises that he'll take care of his people, that those that he loves, that are his children like you and like me, will be safe and protected in his name. And the reason we believe that is because he's always done what he said he would do. Never, ever has God made a promise and then not come through with it. Never, ever has God said he would do something and then not done it. And so today, as we look at this idea that there's a lot of things we don't really know in the world, a lot of things that could be scary to us or uncertain to us about our future, we know that when God promises that he's with us always, that he loves us, that we are his children, that we'll be safe in him, we can trust that promise. He's good, that his promises are good always because he has always come through with what he said before. Let's pray about that. Jesus, we thank you today that you have called us to yourself, called us children of God, and that you've told us that we can trust that you are with us always, even to the end of the age. We know that because you've always been true to your promises before, you will be in the future, and we just pray that we would keep that at the front of our minds, that we'd be ever trusting in your faithful promises. In your name we pray, amen.
Scripture lesson upon which our Pastor Sam's message is going to be based today, and also the scripture passage that ties to the song that we'll be looking at, is recorded in the book of the prophet Isaiah, the 43rd chapter, beginning at verse 1. You can follow along in your Bibles at home if you wish. Isaiah chapter 43, verse 1. But now this is what the Lord says, "He who created you, Jacob, he who formed you, Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I give Egypt for your ransom, Cush and Seba in your stead. Since you are precious and honored in my sight, and because I love you, I will give people in exchange for you, nations in exchange for your life. Do not be afraid, for I am with you. I will bring your children from the east and gather you from the west. I will say to the north, give them up, and to the south, do not hold them back. Bring my sons from afar and my daughters from the ends of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and made." This is the word of the Lord.
Brothers and sisters, grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father, from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Life is unreliable, isn't it? I don't probably need to convince you of that, that life is unreliable, unpredictable, hard to determine. You know, if you'd asked me a year ago, August 2nd of last year, what I thought life would be like on August 2nd of this year, I would have had some answers for you. I would have told you we'd probably be just about to start a week of vacation Bible school. I would have told you we would have maybe just have done an outdoor worship service, church picnic last week. I might have listed any number of ideas or incentives, different things that we might have been thinking about doing here as a family of faith at St. John's, and I would have been wrong about all of it, right? Life is unpredictable. We don't know what it's bringing for us, not just a year from now, but even less than that. That unpredictability is hard in general, but it's been especially hard lately. I know for our family personally, it's been pretty hard because we had just come out of a period of life that was pretty unpredictable, unreliable. And we're supposed to be entering into just normal life, right? We had spent 4 years when I was going through grad school, and in those 4 years, we moved four times. We lived in three different states. We welcomed three new babies into our family in 4 years. or from 15 to 19, we had unpredictable things happening all over the place, and we were looking forward to just a calm and normal year where things would happen just the way they were supposed to happen, just the way we thought they would happen. Well, that hasn't been true. We've, of course, not done VBS. We didn't have a church picnic. I'm preaching into a camera right now, and my family, who is looking forward to really settling down into normal life, has spent many months mostly at home alone. That's not a very reliable thing, is it? Now, how would it be different for you, I wonder, if you were to have predicted a year ago what life would be like today, what would you have said? What are the things that you were certain about that turns out probably would not be true right now? Can you kind of think about what those things are? Now, the reason it's worth noting that life is unreliable is that it really can kind of, it can add up. It can tire us out. It can wear us out, the unreliability of life. If it's just a bill that you weren't expecting or a phone call with some bad news, that can make you tired. But when you spend months in that kind of life, or years in that kind of life, or a lifetime just dealing with the unreliability that life brings at you, it can really wear you down. You know, our faith, our beliefs, our faith practices, they aren't safe from this realm of unreliability either. Personally, I'm a person who generally understands that God has given me promises and His word that I can and should take and use to walk through life's challenges with. But the more challenges come at me, the harder it is to be consistent and holding closely to those promises, especially when I'm all alone, especially when I'm trying to do things on my own. And what can happen is that instead of using God's word to show me where to go in life and what sort of decisions to make, I can allow life's circumstances, unreliable circumstances, to begin and shape what it is I believe about God. And the thing is that I can start to then wonder if God is really going to do what He said He will do. Or I can start to think things like, I wonder what He actually thinks about me if this is the circumstance He's given me. I could start to wonder if even that which He's told me is even true. And that feeling is one that it's hard to know what to do with. What do I do with this feeling can be kind of a question we'd ask. Now, this sort of circumstance where we are dealing with the unreliability of life and not sure what to do with it is an age-old problem. It's not unique to us. It's one that's been around for a long time. There's a story in the book of Deuteronomy, right at the end of what we call the Torah, the first five books of the Bible, where Moses is speaking with Joshua, and it's a similar sort of thing. Now, Moses and Joshua are kind of right at the precipice, where the Israelites are about to enter to what we call the Promised Land. And this is land that God had promised to them generations before, starting with Abraham, and He kept that promise going through Isaac and through Jacob and to Joseph and his brothers, if you remember those stories. Then the Israelites were enslaved in Egypt for hundreds of years, and God did not forget what He had promised them. In fact, He pulled them out of their slavery. He took them out into the desert. There they wandered for 40 years, but He preserved them. And now, at the end of those 40 years, Moses and Joshua are standing right on the other side of a river, basically, from the Promised Land. And Moses is trying to kind of pump Joshua up for the uncertainty, for the unreliability that might lay in front of them. And he says this. He says, "Be strong and bold, for you are the one who will go with this people into the land that the Lord has sworn to their ancestors to give them, and you will put them in possession of it. It is the Lord who goes before you. He will be with you. He will not fail you or forsake you. Do not fear or be dismayed." You see, Joshua is walking straight into uncertainty, straight into unreliable circumstances. And so Moses, rather than letting him slip into doubt or to question what God has promised him because of these coming unreliable circumstances, he instead points him back to the promise of God. Now, that's a model I want to lay out for us today. It is a gift to us that we can look back to the promises of God to carry with us into an uncertain future. And because God has always done what He said He would do, and because He has upheld us and strengthened us in the past, we can be certain He will do that in the future. That's the basic premise and message of the song that we're going to look at today in this Songs of the Church series. The song is called How Firm a Foundation. It's from the 1800s. If you've been around the church for a long time, you might know it. If you haven't, maybe haven't been in services where we play a lot of like songs on the organ, you might not know it all that well, but it's a classic worship hymn from the church. It's one I learned as a little kid at a Lutheran day school. The first verse goes like this. How firm a foundation, you saints of the Lord, is laid for your faith in his excellent word. What more can he say than to you he has said, to you who for refuge to Jesus have fled? What more can he say? That's this question, this kind of rhetorical question asked there. What more can he say than what he's already said to you in his word? And that's something close to what Moses is telling Joshua there before they enter into the promised land. You don't need any new promises because the one he's already made, that this land is for you, is good enough. You don't need any new information than to know that the God who made you, the God who called you, the God who has kept you as his own and preserved you, the God who heard your cry when you were in Egypt, the one who knew about your slavery and he did something about it, has promised that you will go into this land. What more can he say than to you he has said is this question. And we can often slip into this this idea that is basically that our faith and our hope that we have in Christ Jesus is something kind of akin to wishing. We really hope something will come true. And so it's something kind of more like just we wish that that would happen. And that's certainly an idea that people have about faith outside of the church. That it's not what we're doing here. In fact, the foundation for our faith is laid in the Word of God, which has made clear who he is and what his disposition toward us is. His great love for us and the great sacrifice and gift that he's given to us in Christ. Martin Luther, when he was writing about faith once, he said this, faith is a living, daring confidence in God's grace, so sure and certain that a man could stake his life on it 1,000 times. It's a living and daring confidence in God's grace. And it's so sure and certain that you could stake your life on it 1,000 times. And that's rooted, of course, in the promise that he's made and in the way that he's demonstrated that he comes true with what he promises. Now, the first verse here, it talks about this firm foundation we have in God's word. And so you might guess that the next is going to expand on that and talk more about the gift that the word is for us. But it actually takes a slightly different turn. Instead, it goes directly to the word and it starts to look at the promises that God has made. Listen to this. This is the second verse of this hymn. Fear not, I am with you. Oh, be not dismayed. For I am your God and will still give you aid. I'll strengthen you, help you, and cause you to stand upheld by my righteous and impotent hand. You know, this song is predicated on this idea and this truth that even though life is wholly, entirely, and frustratingly unreliable, God is not. He has always done what he said he would do. And so our confession about who he is one that we know can't be wrong. It will be true. He told us that he would give us the gift of Christ Jesus long before he ever did. And then in Christ Jesus, he redeemed and restored the world the way he said that he would. Now he's laid out a promise that says that you who have fled to him for comfort and for refuge will be upheld by his hand. And so you can be confident in whatever unreliable circumstance you're walking through right now, that that is true. What we read in Isaiah 43 is kind of getting to that idea as well. Pastor Mike read for us. But now, this is what the Lord says. He who created you, Jacob, he who formed you, Israel. Remember, when we read about being Israel or Jacob, we know that because we have been grafted into God's family, that's us. Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name, and you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. And when you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. He says, bring my sons from afar and my daughters from the ends of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and I made. You know that old saying that is the only certain things in life are death and taxes, Right? You've heard that before. Think if that's true, which it's mostly probably not meant to be true, but to be funny. If it's true that death is a certain thing for us, think what it means that Christ Jesus rose from the dead. That this curse of sin and death and the devil was so consistent in our world that it grabbed hold of everyone, of course, at their birth in a sinful nature. But what does it mean that Christ Jesus rose from the dead? Of course, it means that even this old reliable thing is now unreliable. That it's not a promise that must come true for you because of what Christ Jesus has done and because of the way he has a victory over death. He stole its power from it. And when he calls you to himself, when you flee to him for refuge, that promise that death is coming is no longer one for you. And indeed won't come true because you have life in his name. And so as you go forward, as those who are gathered by him from the ends of the earth, as those who are created for his glory, as those who are made and formed by him, as he says, you can do it trusting in the promise. You will not be burned in the fire, and you will not be swept over by the waters of a flood of the river. You need not fear. He's redeemed you. He has upheld you and will uphold you by his omnipotent hand. One final, just kind of simple way that the Holy Scriptures say this comes in the New Testament in the words that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. It comes in the book of Hebrews. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. And so his promise to you that you are his, that he will not leave you or forsake you, that he's with you always, is true. Now and forever. Thanks be to God. Amen.
How firm a foundation, ye saints of the Lord, is laid for your faith in his excellent word. What more can he say than to you he has said? Jesus have led. Fear not.
the whole people of God and for all people according to their needs. And especially in our prayers today, we want to remember two families from our congregation. Jamie Hoke's family, whose mother Nancy was called home by Jesus, and also Debbie Van Adder, whose son Timothy was called home by Jesus in these past couple of days. So let us join then in prayer. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we come to you this day with gratitude for your grace and mercy in our lives. For as we go through this life, and we know that we don't have to be afraid because you have kept your promises in the past, and we know that you will be with us as we move into this future. And though there's lots of unknowns about the future we're moving into in these days, we know that we can trust on you and lean on you because you will not leave us alone and that you will be there for us no matter what the future holds. We pray your care and blessing on all who are suffering from the COVID pandemic, both in our country and throughout the world. So many have been affected by it, and we pray that you would bring healing to those who lie sick, that you would give wisdom and knowledge and courage to the frontline medical professionals who care for them, that they might be able to use the skills with which you have blessed them and the knowledge that you've given them to bring healing and hope in the lives of those they care for. And continue to give them your presence as they journey through this time of treatment when it can get very discouraging. Enable them to keep on going with your help. We pray for families who have lost loved ones, that you would bring comfort and hope to them as they make this journey. And we pray for those scientists who are working to bring vaccines and cures for the disease, that they might find those not the knowledge that they need to know to develop those treatments and vaccines. We pray this day especially for the Van Adder and Hoke families as they walk through the valley of the shadow of death in these days. Comfort them with the hope that only you can bring and the peace that comes only from you. Assure them of your love and care for them, even as they mourn the loss of these loved ones. And fill them with hope that there will be a time when we'll be together again in the kingdom that you are creating. We pray for those who are ill in our congregation, remembering Bob and Kathy, the way John and Karen, Don, Leslie, Andrea, Esther, Lauren, Barb, Harold, Rusty, David, Chelsea, Terry, Donna, Wendy, Irene, Bev, and all those that we name before you in our hearts now. Hear their prayers for healing and your presence in this time of need. Be with their families who wait and watch with them that they might be able to bring the comfort and encouragement they seek to bring. All these things and all the other things in our hearts we bring to you this day in the name of Jesus our Lord, who also taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Let's join now and sing.
Of heaven, you stepped down to earth
in its imperfection, you gave your life for us, and we are amazed. Yes, we stand in awe, for we have been changed by the power of the cross. How great, how great is your love. How great, how great is your love. How great, how great is your love for us. In your kindness, you lead me home. In your presence, where I belong, you called me out, you lifted me up. How great is your love! From the heights of heaven, you stepped down to earth.
Church, it's been great to have you worshiping with us today as we've continued on in this series looking at the songs of the church. I hope that this one's been helpful for you. You could look it up this week if you want it. If you want to be reminded of the promises that are here, that you need not fear, for he is with you. You need not be dismayed. Because you have fled to Jesus for refuge, you are his. And that is an eternal promise that he will be good on, because he always has before. As you go into your week, do it with this promise. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you his peace. Now go in that peace and serve the Lord. And thanks be to God.
He's our rescuer. He's our rescuer. We are free from sin forevermore. Oh, how sweet.